You're watching The Dish TV, the talk show from SRI International that highlights the most important part of our institute, our people. I'm Reenita Hora, Head of Marketing and Communications. Today I'm joined by Nathan Collins, Chief Strategy Officer of SRI Biosciences. In the first part of his interview, I ask him about the SynFini platform, one of the latest innovations to come from SRI.
So SynFini is our latest thing. It's based on the idea that chemistry as a sort of discipline of science has not changed in the way that it's been done over the last 200 years. So thinking when you were at high school, when you were mixing chemicals and putting them together, you were using round bottom flasks and long conical flasks and measuring cylinders. And essentially, that's still how people do things today, even in highly advanced areas of chemical research and drug discovery or material science and things like that. And the challenge with that is that you have the experience of the chemist, the knowledge of the chemist that's doing things manually in terms of how making sure that they are actually doing that very, very thoroughly and reproducibly. And also then the method by which they capture the information they do that is also captured manually, and they write it down in a procedure that hopefully someone else who knows how to intuit what they were thinking when they did this stuff actually can then reproduce it themselves. And as a result, the industry's just gotten used to the fact that you have to spend a lot of time trying to reproduce work from one lab to another or one bench to another. Our estimate from some of the studies we've done is that a chemist's time at the bench can be spending about 50 to even 75% of their time just trying to reproduce someone else's work to get it to work in their hands. So we and others have been looking at this problem over the last years, thinking about how could you automate that process so you have a much more faithful process of actually doing the experimentation in the first place and then capturing it in such a way that you can then reproduce it in somebody else's hands. So that's at the core what the SynFini program started out to be.
So if I understand this correctly, in the process of research, a chemist must first do the experiment, but then as a continued part of the research, somebody else needs to come in and effectively redo that experiment.
Well, probably more from the perspective that they will take the research that you've done yourself already, and then they want to apply it in a different way, want to make a different molecule, but they're going to base it off of something that you've already done.
Right?
So that's one aspect of it. In terms of discovery, to discover new molecules, you're incrementally stepping off of this huge field of work, that's body of work that's been done by chemists before you. The other aspect of it, this is when you do have a molecule that's important, other people have to be able to make that molecule and also scale it up to larger amounts of material if you're going to industrialize that process. And both of those are still very, very challenging problems to deal with.
So this is the basis upon which SynFini was developed. Now, talk to me about making molecules. What kind of molecules are we making? Why are we making them? What is our objective?
So there are many, many different applications in the way that chemistry works. The two spaces I think that we've really focused on, given our history, we've been looking primarily at pharmaceutical chemistry development, looking at synthetic drugs as being our primary target. But you can think about things in the material sciences where you're making different types of polymers, different types of catalysts.
So industrial applications of
chemicals. Many of them, yeah. To a large extent, the kinds of things that are needed for the tool like SynFini actually touches on virtually all of this. So it has the potential to impact all of the way that chemistry works right now.
Interesting. But we are focused specifically at this point on pharmaceuticals.
Pharmaceuticals, yes.
So talk to me about that.
So pharmaceutical drug discovery has been around for, again, about 200 years. It's in this space called lovingly small molecules as opposed to big molecules, which are biological molecules, which are a whole other area of interest of SRI in a different program. These are molecules that specifically have traditionally been synthesized by a chemist in the lab to address a particular application, and usually in trying to modulate the activity of a protein in the body to correct some kind of disease.
So the main SynFini platform then looks at making these small molecules, is that right? But then you can also break it down into its components.
So SynFini is a suite of tools for doing this. We started this program, we were looking just at the automation for making molecules. As we started to get into this, we realized actually we needed to also make tools for how to design those molecules as well. So starting at the beginning, what we realized is if someone walks up to a system, we needed to give them a tool to say, what's the best way to make this molecule? Now, we rely primarily on chemist know-how to do that in the past. So we developed a tool called SynRoute, which uses machine learning, basically takes all the information from the literature as well as chemistry know-how, and can give you, if you plug a molecule in, it can give you 10 different ways to make that molecule in about 10 seconds. This would probably take a chemist maybe, you know, two to three days to a couple of weeks to do in the lab. So that's the first tool.
Has that been done before?
AI applications in this particular case, that's new. I think this is a new realm of interest in this particular field, and I think some major transitions and steps have actually been made to actually make this a much more effective tool now. But the second problem that you have from that is you're still using all the literature that I described that has this inherent manual problem that's associated with it. And machine learning isn't going to get over that. It's still going to have all of those problems baked into it. So what we realized quickly after that was, yeah, these 10 routes are probably very good, but you're still going to have to spend a lot of time validating them. So we developed another tool called SynJet, whereas instead of having someone manually putting together a large number of experiments to validate all of these chemistries, we could use inkjet printing technology to print reactions very, very rapidly. And I'm talking about printing a complete reaction makeup in about a second per reaction, where it might take a chemist, you know, a chemist might be able to do 10 of these reactions a day if they're working really hard. We can print 1,000 reactions in an hour.
And why specifically inkjet printing?
Because inkjet printing is extremely fast and is extremely accurate. There are other ways of manipulating chemicals called liquid handling. The trouble with those is you still have a lot of setup time and a lot of effort to manually manage them. Inkjet printing, we can do these things on nanoscale amounts and essentially be very green in the amounts of material we're using, print out the reaction, and just move on to the next step very, very quickly. Putting that together with good high-throughput analytical systems, we essentially can use this as a data generation engine to fill in all the gaps that we have in the literature that, you know, would be very difficult for us to do any other way.
So we've got SynRoute and SynJet.
Correct.
And what else do we have?
Most of the chemicals that you need to make, you need to be working at a larger scale because you need more material to then go and test the properties of these molecules. So the next part of the equation that we built at the core was a platform called AutoSyn, which is lovingly called a flow chemistry reactor. It operates a little differently from the way that things are done in the lab, where people would mix, you know, quantized amounts of materials in a round bottom flask. That's typically called batch reactions. Mm-hmm. In this case, we end up with a system where we're actually pumping the reagents together in a continuous flow method through a series of reactors, where we are actually able to very easily do multi-step reactions now, you know, one reaction after another, all in one go. So that enables us then to be able to very quickly get to target molecules in minutes or hours or even days, where it would typically take us weeks or months to be able to do that. And we can now get it on scales where we can go and very quickly do the testing that we want to get information on those molecules.